Welcome, gentlemen. To anyone who happens to watch the recording, this is the seventh session of a regular old tabletop game of Axe. We are mostly using rules that precede the upcoming Imperial imprint. The main exceptions you will see bring Thieves and Lowlight Vision more in line with the revised designs. We further add Explorers to the core class list and swap their prime requisite to Constitution. However, the world itself has been meticulously built and stocked following the guidelines from the Imperial Imprint Judge's Journal, and those familiar with the AX module series set in the Orin Empire may recognize materials from AX1. Let's begin with introductions. First is Jogrov, a necromancer in the Hansen School of Magic.
Uh-oh.
Nikki died. Unfortunate.
Yep.
Magic and not have a cat. Stop scooping cat.
Are you back? How would someone cast an exile on you?
I'm back.
Okay.
How did we do? Did we get through Jogrov's introduction?
No. Try that again.
All right. Let's begin with introductions.
Yes.
Delightful. So first is Jogrov, a necromancer in the Hansen School of Magic, now the sole surviving thread tying the original party to the current one. He's played by Chris. Jogrov has employed an explorer and field cartographer named Holt. He will be played today by John. Next is Thelma, an explorer recently promoted from her former status as a henchman, following her employer's untimely demise. She's played by Richard. During the last session, Thelma hired three henchmen of her own, Watts, Sendath, and Romit. Watts is a reserve guardsman from the lost village of Aspen and will be piloted as a secondary character by Ross. Sendath is a shifty young man eager to join the party's expedition for reasons that were never discussed. He will be piloted as a secondary character by Chris. And Romit is a young hunter from Lena, the same lost village as Thelma. Actually, it might be Lena, now that I think about it. I think I spelled that wrong. He's joined up to learn the fate of his kidnapped mother, and he will be played by me in a break from our normal convention. And the last of our party members today is Similiricus, an Asconian crusader who took up with the party after a portentous dream convinced him that he had business here. He will be played by Ross. It is the small craft's fate to watch the list of the galleons and pray for light winds. The players guide a band unlucky enough to live in the border marks of one such skiff, the Freeport of Bremen, southern of two tiny nations unfortunate enough to occupy the land bridge between a pair of imperious giants. These looming empires long kept one another in check until a turbulent succession in the sprawling Sultanate of Hansa to the south emboldened hawks in the northerly kingdom of Lacarnum to swoop down unopposed on their neighboring bridge state, Ascona. Hansa now musters its armies in reply to thwart Locarno and claim the corridor for its own. Bremen is merely in the way. The Freeport's saving grace is a crescent of savage and untamed wilderness, spanning the gap between it and the Hansan border. Though the internal borders of Bremen have been severely depleted by the departure of thousands of volunteers going north to fight with Ascona. A month passed before news of Hansa's approach reached four travelers by Bremen's eastern border, leaving them with precious little time to plan an escape or prepare to make a stand. In the first month of play, they got the lay of the land around two of the remote border forts on Bremen's eastern fringes, Ostmarktor and Silsbendtor. This has included three expeditions. The first led the party from Ostmarktor into the Needlebreak, a forest west of the border forts, where they captured a wagon of trade goods from presumed brigands and interrogated a captive from that encounter for directions to a cave where he reported comings and goings of beastmen. Reports have been mounting near Ostmarktor that these beastmen have been raiding and kidnapping entire local villages. The next two outings led the party across the border into the forests east of Sill's Bend, where they discovered mythical beasts, tree spirits, and a mycological intrigue before losing five members in their first joint melee in the woods, and returning to Ostmarktor to refocus and replenish after honoring the fallen. It was there that Similiricus joined the party, and there that Telma hired Watts and Sandath. The reformed group departed again for the Needlebreak, following the directions Jagorov received from his captive a month prior. They ran across a group of furriers just inside the forest, one of whom, Romit, recognized Telma and insisted on joining their expedition for his own reasons. The remainder of the day's travel brought the group to the site of their quarry, a towering black granite dome at the top of a rocky hill, open at the front by a gash in the stone. As the sun began to wester, three scouts approached the gash and found a bronze door within, guarded by a group of caimanid creatures 2.5 feet in height. Though they appeared to share no common language, Jagorov nonetheless managed to delay bloodshed and broker passage for the group at the cost of a gold coin apiece. The date is the first of the stag. The time is 10 minutes to sunset. The graven brass doors are open for your entry. So, tell me now, what do you do?
I invite my new crusader friend to lead us.
I turn back to everybody else. This could be,
okay.
Bots. Some of the new people we hired. This could be what burned your village. And put an end to this.
That would be preferable.
And then do we have a light? Actually, I mean, the door is open. Is it lit inside?
It is not lit inside, although the fading sunlight is still shining in ever so slightly. The gash behind you is quite wide, I should note. It's about 130 feet across, and the distance from the edge of the gash, where you rounded the corner, to the front of the door is 50 feet, plus an extra 10 right in front of the door. So there's some light, but just to get through the door, it's got to be quite strong from the outside.
I'm sorry, when you say gash, I must have misunderstood. Are you referring to a terrain feature at the entrance?
Yes. This dome is unbroken on all sides, except for a cut, a wide cut or break in the stone.
Oh, it's sort of like a low cavern overhang, like a shallow cavern, like a gash at the bottom.
Yes.
Okay. I'm gonna make a note.
Like it doesn't quite touch the ground in one spot, but everywhere else around, it's
like the
not uniformly
sort of
sealed, but it's certainly closed off.
Gotcha. A brief aside for the audience. Clarified, the size of this dome is enormous. It's 400 feet tall. It's large as the Jetta Vanaramaya in Sri Lanka. It's huge.
Okay. Let's see. My shield.
There is one person who can tote a. I think Sandath is in a good position to be a torchbearer.
Actually, I don't have a shield. Yes, I do have a shield. Yes.
You do.
Okay.
You definitely
do. I ask Sandath to light a torch. I hand him one, and then I go into the room.
Sandath takes it nervously.
Okay. You are, by the way, being welcomed in, just to be clear, by 4 guards at the door. This isn't an unguarded entrance. These are people you've just paid... people, if you want to call them that, who you've just paid a gold each for your entrance, and they are giving you mean eyes. One of them ran off a while ago. There was one more guard than you see now when you initially approached the door.
Okay.
And it's now been almost 10 minutes since he left.
What does the room look like on the other side of the door?
Have you lit a torch? You said you did, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Two of them.
Okay. It extends 20 feet forward into a wall, and then appears to be a hallway of that width going to your left and to your right, much further than the torchlight extends.
Okay.
20 feet forward to a wall on the... So it is we are entering a 20-foot wide hallway from the side. That's what I'm hearing.
That's correct. Yes.
Okay.
And on the far wall, 30 feet over from where you are, you can see a door going forward into the far side.
Okay.
For convenience, I will remind you, if I forgot to mention this before, my mistake, you entered from the south, and you do know what direction you entered from because of how you were navigating.
All right.
Okay. I'm sorry. This is a room, or is this a hall?
It seems to be more of a hallway than a room, but it's wide. 20 okay. feet wide.
And you said this hallway goes both left and right.
That's correct.
Okay. So it's a T intersection. It's 20 feet where it turns into an intersection.
Nope, it opens straight into this 20-foot wide hallway. Oh, we're going to get to play the mapping game where we figure out how to talk to each other for a bit.
This is why I usually... Oh, boy.
Well, what is the 20 feet to, then?
That's the width of the hallway.
So it terminates in a door in the hallway. Like, what's it terminate at? It's 20 feet.
A wall.
A wall. It's dead ends.
So...
The hallway extends from the east to the west. From the south. We are entering from the south side. Yes. The hallway is from north to south, 20 feet wide.
It's
now, you mentioned the door on the north face of the wall. Yeah.
Yes.
The hallway stretches is 20 feet from the south wall to the north wall.
That's
you mentioned
correct.
On the north wall that there is a door, which opens into the north wall. Is that
yes.
And it is 30 feet away from our current position, east or west?
East. It's 30 feet away from your current position, east. And it is in the north wall.
Thank you. And we are currently being overseen by three kobolds. Obviously, in character, I don't know that it is a distinct group, but I'm just going to call them kobolds.
That's a good name.
I don't know. I don't know what a kobold is. In fact, none of you know what a kobold is either.
But sure we do. It's that thing. Whatever that thing is.
Okay.
All right. So, and then they're leading us, right?
No. They just took your money and they're
leaving us alone.
They
one of them just tampered off to
done precisely like, that.
Notify someone or fetch something. Did I catch that correctly?
You have no idea. There were five of them when you approached the door, and one of them disappeared into the doorway before you made your initial approach to kill them, and then instead of killing them, parlay.
Well, this is great. This worked out really well, because now we can go figure out what's at the cause of all this as soon as we find human bodies. So these things seem insignificant and just took our money and walked away. So I propose that we...
They didn't walk away. They took your money, and they are staring at you, waiting for you to leave.
Well, I propose we don't leave, and we turn left down the hallway and see if they leave us alone.
Okay.
These creatures don't seem like they'd have the strength to burn down an entire village, so I have to assume they're working for someone.
Yes, if they're just...
They also could... we do not know their forces.
True.
The number of their forces.
True, there might be way more of them.
Hmm. So, as you begin your procedure down the left branch of this hallway, the western leading branch of this hallway,
okay.
You observe readily that the north wall is surfaced with stucco and decorated with a magnificent series of fresco paintings.
Nice. What do they represent?
This is a good question. What they represent is not something I can tell you straight away, but I can tell you the picture. The first fresco that you come upon depicts four slender, dark-haired, brown-skinned rulers arrayed in the regalia of a sorceress, a warrior, a sage, and a priest.
Portraits of someone important.
Okay.
And does Chakrov recognize any of them with his lore mastery?
Not with that roll.
C'est la vie.
And it's not, they're not famous enough to be obvious to, like, somebody who's knows, well, actually, I guess I don't really know. I'm not, like, a history proficiency person, so.
Yeah, knowledge history, or knowledge de par would probably make this trivial.
It does say, though, that a whatever it is, wizardry or something. It says I will recognize any insignia, any of the symbols of any of the houses, like schools of magic or whatever.
Yes, these are not Hansons. You know that.
Okay.
Okay, so these are on the north wall of the corridor, right? The frescoes.
That's correct. And remind me of your dungeon movement. I want to tell you how many feet you've traveled per turn real quick.
We entered the corridor.
Yeah, what's your exploration pace?
Oh, the pace.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Ross. I just want to make sure I know that, because this does matter.
I think our best movement is 10. Because what? Of the cleric.
I have 10 in combat, base movement rate of 30.
Oh my god. Please tell me that you left something with the horses.
Oh, hang on a second. There's an error in his sheet. The sheet thinks that a single 50-foot length of rope is a full burden. So if I...
No, that's correct. 50 feet of rope should weigh 10 pounds. That should be a stone.
Oh. In that case, you probably want to leave that with the horses.
Also, what are you doing with the horses? This is an important question, too.
That is a good question. I think we left them tied to us. I think we left them tied off to a tree. So we probably can't stay down here too long, or else we will come back and something will have eaten them.
Okay. Duly noted. I assume you left them some
distance. I think we only brought one with us, though.
Okay. Just the one horse left tied to a tree, a turn's travel from the entrance to the cave.
How did your movement get all the way down to 10?
Are you talking about me?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay,
the culprits are probably rope or torches, because torches are quite heavy if you're carrying like 12 of them.
I can't speak for the spreadsheet. I appreciate the help of the spreadsheet, but I calculated the stones using the book on the character sheet.
Okay, so he's carrying a stone of rations and two stone of torches. And a stone of rope. So that's four stone right there of stuff that you might not need all of.
I just condensed because I thought that I think the book said that any basic items, so I have like belt, stuff I'm wearing, I think it says not to count the things you're wearing. This is off the top of my head, I can't remember, but like the basic stuff, you put it together, I had like, I think it was like two stone or something off the top of my head. I do have two stone of iron rations. I do, and I have, I think the manacles, I think, weigh a lot. And
those are an item. Light.
And then everything else is like my equipment, though. Shields and armor.
Yeah. So sorry for the diversion. I'm looking at the sheet. Everything in it is correct. I would say the things that are probably weighing you down are that length of rope, the fact that you're carrying 20 pounds of torches, which is reasonable to be carried by a party, but I don't know if one person needs it on hand, and you're carrying a full stone of rations. If you don't need to bring all of those into the dungeon, you can drop four stone and get down to 60-foot.
I'm sure someone else could carry the torches.
Yeah, I've got room. Let me see how many I can carry before I drop slower than... If I just take all 12, how fast do I go? Yeah, I can carry all 12 and only drop down one size category. So yeah, hand them over.
Your henchmen are also, two of them are unarmored and probably have a substantial amount of weight they can carry.
That is true.
You're welcome to... I'm not going to say hand wave it completely, but I think it's a safe assumption that you can just say we give them our burdens to bear.
Yeah, because I'm at 20 feet, so maybe I can, whatever gear I've got, maybe I can shuffle that over.
Yeah, and again, in his case, he's carrying a lot of rations and a lot of torches. But he's in leather armor and should be able to move very fast.
If you want to leave, here's what I recommend. If there's something that you want to leave by the horses, just like write it in your saddlebags, which is just to the right of the consumables section. And then just remove it from your consumables, and that will decrease your weight.
I'm sorry, I'm not. we're talking in about two different things right now. So, it is clear we need to use. I've got to look at the sheet. You're saying yes. I see movement. You're talking about the sheet, right? Or are you talking about, talking about the spreadsheet? Or are you talking about, okay, so.
That's the one.
So, spreadsheet and four. Mount.
You want to look at cell L29.
I think you. Oh, you mean my individual sheet? I've not been using.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I'm sorry. I have not been using the spreadsheet. So
that's fine.
Long
as you guys know your movement speed, I don't need you to use this. This is just a tool.
But all of this fictionally. Could be resolved. First of all, thank you, Thelma, for carrying the torches. Second of all, the horses, which we have to come up with a plan with anyways. We're just going to have to stick somebody out here, I think. Or we could do the old classic, what's that horse from Lord of the Rings? What's his name? Bill or whatever? Good luck, you know.
Bill the pony.
Good luck, Bill.
None of us.
I don't think we have enough history with the horses to pull that off yet.
Immortal avatar of the Maya who can literally bless you for safety.
Yeah. I don't think we are.
But we also don't.
Speak
none
with
of us
animals
are
is suddenly seeming like a much stronger spell than I thought originally.
Oh no, it has a lot of utility.
So someone then must stay. That is so. So if that is the case, then they can have these rations. And thank you, horse.
Ramon, you want to cover the rear? We've got so many guys.
He will look conflicted, but he will look conflicted because he wants to go inside. But he's realizing that he may have been somewhat impulsive in joining you to begin with, and is willing to wait outside now that he's seen what's here. Sure.
All right. We'll be back later. Just make sure that... Just try and keep the horse alive and keep yourself alive, too. If worse comes to worse, book it back to town. And stay safe, and we'll meet you there, okay?
If worse comes to worse, I don't know if we'll be meeting each other anywhere. But I'll do what I can.
You're not getting rid of me that easy.
I'll also leave my manacles.
Hell smile.
No, I'm going to keep the manacles.
Manacles are worth keeping.
The manacles are not very heavy. They're a single item, not a stone. Anyway, so leaving things like rations and extra torches, like I don't know if you're going to need 12, right? That's 12 hours worth of torches. I think you guys can probably get down to a 60-foot speed, limited mainly by Symbolicus being in heavy armor.
Mm-hmm.
Does that seem reasonable to you guys as a plan? Or do you want to try to push him below 7 stone to get to 90 feet? Which would be your next threshold.
No, I can easily get to 7 stone by The manacles, oh, cool. Either somebody else can carry them or I'll leave them.
Gimme.
Then somebody else can pick up the treasure. Thank you. I'll also...
Great. That will put you guys at a 90-foot exploration speed as a party. Thank you for indulging the logistics. It won't be a regular thing. Probably that's the last time it will come up all night.
Important stuff. That's important stuff.
It's important to work out at the beginning.
Okay. You want me to take a few torches? Because I've got a lot, too. I had 12. And
they're not expensive. You can just ditch the extras at the gate. We can pick them up when we come back. I don't know what we'll steal.
I also thoroughly agree that encumbrance is important.
Okay. Okay, Ross, I am stealing 6 torches from your character sheet.
Okay. Then I will leave the other 6, and I'll put a note here.
Okay.
Now, Ross, I'm sorry that I interrupted you earlier. You had just started exploration. You were excited.
No,
moving left down the hallway. You'd seen this stucco fresco and just begun to move beyond it or ask some other question.
No. Joke's on you. I'm into that. I got excited about encumbrance, actually.
Number!
Did the fellow go this way near the fresco, the guy who ran off?
That's a good question. You don't know. To clarify the situation, there were 5 guards at the door when you guys approached it originally, the scouts. The scouts then fell back to gather the rest of the group. The rest of the group came up to approach the doors, originally planning to kill these things that were guarding it. They changed their mind at the last moment when it seems they were mistaken for not enemies by them, the guards, and by the time that you had come back to the door, only 4 were still there, and the door was still open. It's quite a heavy door. So all you know is one of them ran off, probably, or went inside, and you haven't seen him since. But that was before you could see inside.
So they're gone.
The 5th man is gone.
All right.
Yes.
Well, this is a good outcome, I think.
So we traverse to the 90 feet to the, what's the word I'm looking for, to the west.
Yes, and after 90 feet, the, after 90 feet, you can see that the hallway extends to the edge of your torchlight and ends somewhere in the dim light section of the flickering section of your torch. Now, torchlight is 30 feet, plus 30 feet of shadowy illumination. So if that's helpful for you, it's somewhere between 30 and 60 feet, or 40 and 60 feet away is when this terminates.
Okay.
And when I say you've moved 90 feet, I do not count the first square. I count middle to middle of a square, if that's helpful to you. So you have actually added 9 squares onto the one that you were originally standing in.
Gotcha.
Are the ceilings here broken or are they formed? Like, is this a structure that's been placed down here, like the stone ceilings? And is it like high and vaulted, or, you know, can I jump up and tap it?
So the walls and the ceiling of the temple, if it is indeed what it is, or of the ruin or of the...
Oh, you already said temple. It's a temple.
Whatever this tunnel is. Well, there's a reason that I said that. Which you will come to find.
Oh, no.
Briefly. The walls and ceiling are made of splotchy ochre stone, joined together with this asphalt mortar. And on the north wall, you see stucco. You assume that stucco is set on top of something similar. And the floors are composed of fired brick, also embedded in an asphalt mortar. That's what you see. Still sticky. It's quite dry.
Yeah, I was thinking about... I had a confused conception of what asphalt was for like a second. Remember, no, that's not what asphalt is.
Well, I think we ought to just carefully continue down this path until we reach an intersection or something else that we can explore or consider. We should also look to see if there's any changes in the frescoes or the walls that seem out of place.
Mm-hmm.
You've proceeded far enough to reach a new fresco on the north wall. This one is cracked and broken. At the top of it, a long-headed, brown-skinned man in robes sits cross-legged, with his hands stretched downward at an angle. A young man and a young woman stand below his right and left hands, respectively. Their heads are bowed, and their cupped hands reach out toward the extended palms of the cross-legged man.
Cut? What do you mean cut?
Cupped.
Cupped. Like, cupped. I'm sorry. Cupped. Cupped hands. Yeah, like that. Oh, like yes. Yeah, like as in supplication, and he's like,
Is this different enough that I can make another lore roll attempt here?
Absolutely.
When this was 60 feet.
You can
feet
roll
later.
Lore on everything.
All right. Well, I.
This
expected.
Was. You know these frescoes are quite wide. The one sort of blended into the next, but this was a distinct theme.
Looks like he's a.
And you would
teacher.
Say. Yeah. So you don't know. You don't have any secret knowledge of this.
I need to step away for a moment to go to the restroom, and I'll be right back.
Go ahead.
Okay, this occurred 120 feet down, or another 40... I'm sorry, 30...
Feet. 90 feet. Your movement speed is 90 feet. Each turn...
So we traveled 90 feet. We didn't go to the... Okay, so 180 feet from the...
Nope, you've only traveled for one turn. 90 feet to the west.
Okay. Okay. Fresco. All right. Mm-hmm. And we don't see anything. The corridor continues on to the edge of where the light begins to dim. Torch light.
Yeah.
Okay. And nobody has a lantern or anything, right? I don't.
I have oil for a lantern, but...
All right. I think we should just... Well, actually, do we have... I don't know if this is an item in this game, but let me throw it out to you two. I think we should investigate the wall here since it's a change in pattern to see maybe if we have something... To tap it with to see if there's a mechanism on the hands or if something's being given or if there's a, you know, something like that. Including a thing coming out of the wall and stabbing us. Does anybody have like a pole or something? I do not.
Oh, no, no.
If that's the case, then I'll just go and inspect it with my hands and take the risk.
Okay. So you're touching this. What are you hoping to find?
I'm looking for...
What would you consider a success?
Yeah. So I'm trying to make sure that this isn't some kind of... there's not something hidden here because, especially the detail about the hands, like if this is something where, like a trap, you know, like, or, you know, yeah, if there's anything where the space is designed to change based on the art. The first thing I would check would be like the hands. Is there a mechanism, an opening, difference where the stone, a place where the stone is different. Are these all like solid stone slabs that have been put in here, or the wall, the cavern has been cut, like the stone has been cut from the wall?
Okay, so there's a couple of different questions in there. I'll go through them in order. First,
I'm hoping to discover if there's a bad secret or a good secret.
It could be a good secret, but I'm real worried about the bad secret. That's all.
No, that's fair. This all makes sense. To the best of Similaricus' assessment, this fresco is nothing more than a fresco. It is delicate, and it is cracked, and it is not exploding or causing any sort of discernible magical effect when he touches it. As he approaches it, he can see another 30 feet to the west along the north wall, close to the center of the fresco, is a door, a closed door. And from there, the hallway extends another 10 feet before reaching its terminus, and it turns south, staying 20 feet wide.
Get a better piece of paper.
So this is excluding the original square that you started in, 130 feet west to the wall. At the 120th foot in the north wall, there is a door.
Okay.
The hallway turns straight south along the 120th and 130th foot, remaining 20 feet wide.
I have to get out of here.
Oh no.
Just crumple that into the microphone. Just a little.
Hang on a second. This is very stupid. I'm going to just go ahead and turn off my fancy filter so that you can see what in the world I'm showing you. Sparing us all a great deal of confusion.
Okay.
Come on to focus. So we came in here, went west, and we found this little corridor going up and down and south. There's a little door that's right on the corner.
I believe that door is 10 feet further left. It's at the 120th foot, excluding the original square.
Alrighty. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, so in that case, the
hallway extends another 10 feet past the door before it hits its wall. Okay, so Similaricus has investigated the frescoes.
Yeah.
They appear to just be frescoes.
Okay.
Most frescoes are. This place looks like it could be a maze. I don't want to overcomplicate it. You want to just hug the left wall and see where it takes us?
Yeah. This is reasonable.
Okay. You've spent 20 minutes in your third turn, which is the 10-minute unit of time in Axe. I believe that nomenclature is the same as that you're using in Swords of the Wizardry.
Yes.
You will... Oh, I guess it's the same as BX. So you'll follow this hallway south. Starting in the new section of the hallway, it proceeds 50 feet south, remaining 20 feet wide. And on the 60th foot, you can see that the hallway continued forward, but it's buried under rubble. That wall seems to have collapsed. Collapsed inward under the weight of something. Or maybe just with time.
Are there any other doorways or anything at the end of this, near this hallway?
Yes. From the north wall, at the 60th foot, there is a doorway leading east. Sorry, west. Not east, west.
Okay, I apologize. I'm trying to catch up here.
That's effective.
Are there furnishings?
It's a good question. There are no furnishings that you can see, though there are some signs of old sconces that may have held lights at some point. A lot of them are badly degraded with time, as iron is wont to do. But you can see the holes of that used to house screws or nails or what have you.
So, I'm sorry. So, just to catch up here, after the overhang, double door, 20.
You're
20...
currently muted, Ross. Oh.
It's weird too because can you guys hear me now?
Yes,
you loud and clear.
Discord was showing something totally different too. It's probably gonna die on me. It was showing that my camera was off. I don't know, whatever. Anyways. I said a few things that whole time. I'm sorry. Let me make sure here. Corridors, 20. The corridor's 20 foot wide, and the entrance was also 20 foot wide, with a double door.
The double door was 10 feet wide.
Oh gosh.
But the door itself was actually 10 feet wide. It was quite a wide door.
Okay. All right. So 10 foot wide, and then we get into the corridor, and the corridor is 20 feet, and went left and right. We didn't see what was to the right. We turned left. We went down 90 feet. There was a change in the fresco at 90 feet, and then we continued down for another 30 feet, and then there was a 90-degree turn to the south with a door to the right. That is to the north. Sorry, I'll start saying north, south, east, west.
That is to the west. Oh, yes, sorry. There was a door to the north.
Door to the north. We didn't go in it, right?
You have not gone in any doors. You proceeded left.
Left, down the corridor.
The one turn in the corridor, yeah.
Gotcha.
You just followed the corridor,
gotcha.
Which remains 20 feet wide. From entrance to wall, excluding the entrance square, it was 130 feet. And when it turned south, it stayed within the bounds of that 130 feet. It was the 13th and 12th square you go south on.
Right. And then how far have we gone down the corridor after the 90-degree turn to the south?
You can see that its terminus is 60 feet south.
One, two.
But that those last two squares, or the last square, the last 10 feet of it are partially buried in rubble.
Oh, okay. So when you say it's partially buried in rubble, you mean that does it look like, I look up the ceiling, does it look like it's just a cave-in? Or does it look like it's unfinished? What appears to have happened?
It looks more like it's collapsed than that it was unfinished.
Okay.
Most of the construction here looks like it's quite good. It's worked bricks of good, not outstanding, but good size. This wasn't some great wonder of the world, but this was definitely not a haphazard construction.
Okay. What do you guys think? Oh, go ahead.
In the second branch, there was another door that leads westward. From that collapsed rubble square, the 60th foot southward of this 80-foot stretch of hallway, including the corner, 30 feet up from the south wall,
there's 30
a doorway
feet
leading west.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. The third square up from the south wall.
Okay. 30 feet up from the cave-in?
Yes.
Okay.
Including the square that the cave-in is in.
Okay. My good fellows, is there anything in particular we're looking for?
Yes. Sorry, actually. These gentlemen... Watts and some others, their entire village was burned to the ground by culprits that lay somewhere within this forest. And we gained some information as to beastly creatures, supposedly. Now, my friend here believes that they're not beasts at all. In fact, that they're just simply men. Either way, we find the corpses of people here, or the acts of, some evidence of this, then we'll know.
We don't know what this place is, but right now we don't have any better leads.
Also, I'm almost out of money.
Yeah. We suspect there might be treasures here. Most usually are on ancient ruins like this. So this door here, can you describe it? The one that's 30 feet from the collapsed wall? Or rather, the collapsed end of the tunnel?
Yes. The door is made of thick planks of what looks to be old-growth hardwood and reinforced with green patinated bronze.
Oh, nice.
You see no hinges and assume that the door would open inward. Away from you.
Does it have any sort of locking mechanism?
It has a handle sort of mechanism, a latch mechanism on the right side.
Is it pretty quiet so far?
Yes, eerily so.
I say we take a peek inside.
Sure.
Agreed. Be careful.
Is it Malurkus? You're the most heartily swathed in iron. You want to dare poke in this door?
So be it. By her will. I don't know what to say. But I open the door.
You, in fact, do not open the door. I do not open the door. You try. But it yields not to your polite latch lifting and hand pressing.
Did it make any sound? I mean, have we already made some noise now?
Well, yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, we're kind of clanking around, aren't we?
Yeah, you weren't exactly knocking, but you will have made some noise if something was awake and reading a book very quietly on the far side, perhaps.
I'm gonna shoulder it. I'm gonna bang into it.
Okay. Why don't you go ahead and make a dungeon bashing roll? That is an 18 plus on a d20. And if you have a strength bonus, you will add +4 to your roll for every point of strength bonus.
All right,
if
I rolled
someone would
17.
Like to assist you, if someone would like to assist you, one sec, they can also add +4 to your roll.
Assist, of course.
Okay. The two of you crash through the door. It gives. It is still on its hinges.
Oh, good.
And has swung wide.
What yields on the other side?
The door opens into a 30-foot deep, 40-foot wide room. You are in the second square from the north.
30-foot deep, 40-foot wide. Gotcha.
Yeah. It's 30 feet across in front of you, 40 feet to the
gotcha.
Sides. It mostly looks like it's collapsed into rubble, especially on the south wall.
Alrighty.
The room appears to be empty of almost anything but a dusty skeleton wearing what appear to be white clumps of rags sprawled just south of a tattered curtain in a western doorway. That western doorway is one square north of the south wall.
All right. I have abandoned graph paper completely now. Dungeon Scrawl is too convenient.
Dungeon Scrawl is great.
All right.
I'm sorry.
Let's look at the skeleton. It's just been dead a long time. I mean, you would expect a skeleton to be dead for a long time. Just making sure.
Yeah. It
I would
is...
like to...
Go ahead.
Oh, I'd like to get a closer look at the skeleton.
Okay. It is completely dry. It's been dead for a very long time. The marrow is completely gone. It's brittle. It's old. And the two of you, who have investigated more carefully, can see that these are, in fact, not rags at all that are clumped on the spider. Are clumped on the skeleton, but spider eggs. Yes. Ooh. I can speak. It's been a long morning, gentlemen.
I can believe this.
Spider eggs?
spider eggs, yes, clumped on the skeleton.
Look up.
Okay. You see fired brick ceiling.
I propose we destroy every egg.
Do any of you have the alchemy or animal training proficiencies?
I think...
Okay, I've just clipped through everyone's sheets and none of you do.
No.
They know, yeah.
Okay.
Door on the western wall?
Yes, there is a doorway on the western wall.
Oh, it's open. What's on the other side then?
It's... you can't see.
Oh, okay.
It's covered with a tattered curtain.
Oh, okay. Well, that's not going to defend us from whatever's on the other side, so I take my weapon and gently lift aside the curtain to cast it in torchlight.
Okay. You can see that past the doorway, which is itself something of a 10-foot-long hole, the chamber within extends another 10 feet to the wall and then turns to the left and the right.
T intersection, and it's also still 20 feet wide?
Okay. No, 10 feet. This is a 10-foot wide intersection.
Okay.
All right. I've started streaming my dungeon scroll to the Discord. So let me know if that looks approximately correct.
Now, what's the story with these eggs? One of you proposed destroying them.
Who is our loot carrier? I believe that is... Sorry. Sandath, you're the one with the torch. Can you light those on fire for us?
My pleasure.
Show us how soon Sandath, hands.
Sandath will... with the practiced hand of one who knows how to set things on fire, he will... and a strange gleam in his eye, he will deftly thrust the torch amongst the bones and three strategic thrusts of the torch.
Okay.
And then stand back to admire his work.
I briefly share a slightly concerned glance with Holt.
The webs do not catch fire.
Sandeth doesn't notice.
They don't burn?
He looks frustrated.
They don't burn, but they do wither. You are satisfied that they've been destroyed, but as it turns out, spiderwebs don't ignite.
Oh, that's so disappointing. I didn't know
Love how it melts away.
It does melt away in a very satisfying way. They peel back when they're exposed to the heat.
I really wish
you could have...
Oh, go ahead.
Any more, boss?
I wish you could have met Zafyar. You would have liked him.
I lean into Zhagrav and I say, I worry about this one.
Every fool has his uses.
Rude. All right. Well, at least those won't hatch on us later.
He says, and then gives you the side eye. Surely you have noticed its principle, even
Why
in your
are we like this?
Line of work.
Similaricus, he like sagely nods, like, yeah. Like, he thinks that Zhagrav is like this, like, studied, you know, academic mystic, which he is, and doesn't realize the discipline he studied, that's all.
Yeah.
So, I want to come back to Similaricus. He saw something else inside of there that might be of interest. Not an emergency, but against the west wall lining it were a number of, quite a number of clay jars. Below a series of windows opening onto black granite. Almost all of the jars are broken. But that's the other thing that he saw in there.
Describe that one more time? That sounded fascinating. I think I didn't quite catch that.
Yeah. Lining the west wall, he'll see a large collection of clay jars. Probably a couple hundred, he thinks. Sitting below a series of windows that open directly into black granite.
Huh. That's odd.
Yeah, does that have some sort of religious meaning that I would recognize based on the theology feature?
Which part? The jars or the windows opening
into
black granite?
Yes, well, both. Does this represent... Oh, you want me to say, well, yes. the jars, would that... Is this like a funereal kind of thing, or does it mean something else, or would I know? Does the granite wall distinguish this as some sort of, you know, specific religious sect that I would know, or something like that?
You can roll me a d20. You're looking for an 11 plus for theology, if you'd like to know the theological significance of any of these.
And a fail.
Okay. You're not sure if there's any theological significance to these. Most of them are broken. They don't appear to have been containing any, like, you know, viscera or whatever. You don't see bloodstains. But you're also not in the room. You're standing in the doorway holding it aside and holding a torch.
I rolled an 18 on a lore roll.
Okay. To do what? What were you investigating with that roll?
Well, anything and everything I come across that's different from what I've seen before. So in here, I guess these urns, there's no furnishings. I don't remember. Did you describe a wall?
You just saw the wall. But have you guys entered? Are you leaving the room with the skeleton and proceeding into this next room?
Yeah, yes. I'm looking at that weird granite. I assume the granite is a different type of stone. Like maybe it was added on later, and this used to look outside.
Well, you will recognize that this black granite is identical to the black granite of the dome covering everything.
Oh! This is like... So this... Telma gets briefly incoherent-ish, like an idea comes into her head, and she fails to express it sanely before she, like, stops and is like... I think those used to be, like, windows to the sun and the sky and the world. Then they put the dome on top of it. They didn't build this in the dome. They built this, then someone put the dome on it.
It's impossible. No, even at the height of Skonan culture, we couldn't have lifted a dome 400 feet tall and cast it upon this place without destroying everything.
Maybe they
even
just built the dome from bricks. Maybe they poured it.
Yeah.
I'm going to interject for just a moment. This is a good argument to get into. Since you've entered this room, it's become clear to you that it's 40 feet long, north to south. You entered. It shares its placement with the room that you just left to get in here, the same 40 foot height. I also need you to roll me surprise.
Oh, fun!
And tell me what your marching order is.
Our marching order is listed in the quick reference sheet.
Got it. I'm looking now. Okay.
Okay, so 40.
Hold Talma Watts, Similaricus Jagrav, and
yes.
You're missing Sandath.
Am I? Beans.
Yes.
Sandath probably goes with Jagrav since he is...
Understood.
He's not a frontliner.
Okay, now roll me surprise and let me know the result. Holt has a plus one on surprise, and Talma has plus two.
All right, as the person with the highest, I will roll the surprise.
Well, I mean...
Is this for each of us, or...?
You're rolling once for the party, but you will apply your bonuses individually. That is to say, if you roll a two, Talma would not be surprised, but other people wouldn't.
Yeah. None of us are surprised. I rolled a three.
Okay. Unfortunately, the thing that you are trying not to be surprised by imposes a penalty on surprise.
Oh.
So everyone is going to be, let me think about the math on this real quick. Everyone except for Telma is going to be surprised when two giant spiders, the color of the ceiling, flop down right on top of.
Nice.
I share a meaningful look with Ross. This again.
Right on top of Holt.
For the fourth time
and
now.
And Jagrov.
Goodbye.
Huh. Yeah.
You'll be fine. You've got so many hit points.
It's not the hit points.
Nothing bad could possibly happen.
It wouldn't matter
this
how many
being
hit points,
a surprise right? round. This being a surprise round, Telma will have a chance to interact with them in initiative. So Telma should roll me initiative.
That's a 1d6, right?
That is a 1d6 plus your dex.
I rolled a 1! So that is a whopping... Actually, no, I've got combat reflexes or something like it.
You have alertness, which gives you a surprise bonus and a listening bonus.
Yes.
Oh, you do also have combat reflexes because, animal reflexes. Right, all right, yeah, plus 1.
Actually, so does Holt.
Yeah, but Holt's surprised.
Oh, yeah. But that Holt's also applies to... It also applies to surprise, is what I mean.
Right. It gives him plus 1. These things impose a penalty of minus 2 because of...
Oh, okay. A cursed minus 2. In that case, I will... So I get a... Effectively, I go on 3.
Okay. So did they.
I am going to attempt to smack one off of... let's go with Jagrov.
Okay. There are fewer combatants on their side than on yours, so they will win the tiebreaker.
Okay.
I'm sorry to say.
Okay.
So, they're going to make... One of them is going to make an attack against Jagrov.
I'm sure my AC is 10.
Okay. It rolls a 17, so I think it will handily hit. I would like you to... Roll me a save versus poison. As its fangs sink in.
14, which I think passes. Yes.
Wow, it does pass. Okay.
Wow.
Jagrov takes 2 damage from the bite. And you see this spider's skin immediately change color to a sort of dull purplish gray. From the color of the ceiling that it had blended in with before. Now for Holt. I'm so sorry if you die in the first round, man. This is not what I had in mind. But there's other characters.
That's awesome.
John, it rolls a 9.
I will.
What is your AC?
It's a 3.
Okay, so let me just check. It's a 9 up. Wow. Holt wards off this thing's blow. This giant dog-sized spider.
I think of a picture I got like a mouthful of spider butt and I'm like trying to shove it off.
It comes at you fast, but not fast enough. Telma.
How come my AC says 0?
I attack it with my hand axe. Let's not complicate this.
How come your AC says what?
0 on my sheet.
You probably have AC 0.
Alright.
That's on armor max.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
I roll a 13, so that'll hit AC 3.
Okay. Roll me damage.
Alright. Oh, sorry, that'll hit AC 2. Well, that still hit.
Roll me damage.
Okay. Yeah, that cancels out. 6.
Well done. You take off one of its legs, but it's not going down yet.
Die, you horrible thing.
All right, gentlemen. You're going to roll me initiative for the second round of combat, which you have miraculously all survived into. Each of you is going to roll me a d6. You will modify it by your dexterity, and if you have... combat reflexes, or animal reflexes. Each of those are plus one. Holt has plus one to initiative from a feature, and possibly also from Dex. Yeah, Holt has a total of plus two to initiative.
Not bad.
Okay. I'm going to count down, and when I reach your number, you may tell me that you're going or that you're delaying. We've already joined melee, so there's no real movement. If any of you want to move into the melee, you're welcome to do so. These things are both locked in and can't move. Is anyone going to cast a spell this round?
It's not possible if I'm in melee, is it?
It is possible to cast spells in melee and axe. If you fail a save or take damage, your spell will be ruined. You can absolutely cast in melee.
Which one is the one that was wounded? The one that was on me?
Mm-hmm. No. Oh, yes! The one that was on you is badly wounded.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to cast a spell.
Okay. Now, these things are among you, so...
Yeah.
I hope you can just picture with me here, looking at the marching order, if you're able to. One of them is between Holt and Watts, and the other one is between Similaricus and Jagrov, although Telma wrapped around to be next to it as well. Orders for henchmen. Sandoth and Watts need to know what to do.
Shoot, I assume shooting into melee has the same risks as other things.
It's straight
it's
up.
It's actually not allowed an axe without a proficiency.
Got it. In that case, I mean, if he can figure out a way to get a stab in, Sandath will try that.
Okay, he's welcome to.
Yep.
All right.
What's
what?
I don't know when does. Do I have to roll for Sandath's initiative too?
No. Yes, please. Can go on. Oh, okay, yeah, that's fine. Yeah, you can roll. That's fine.
Oh, nice. That's okay. Much better.
Is anyone going on an 8? Sandath has plus 2 to initiative as well, by the way. He has very high dex.
Oh, well then Sandath is going on an 8.
Okay, he may roll his attack.
Okay. Sixteen plus whatever.
That'll hit.
Yeah. D4?
Straight D4, dagger. Yeah. He has no strength bonus or penalty.
2 damage on that one. Excellent. That was wounding his buddy.
Okay, you take off another of its legs. It's withering, but it's not out yet. Is anyone going on a 7? Is anyone going on a 6?
Watts.
Okay.
It's funny, Richard, because I'm over here on my screen for you. But it's cool. Anyways, yes, okay. He attacks the thing and
kill
misses.
It.
And
you must kill it.
Anyways.
Okay. The spider in the north, the one engaged with Holt and Watts, will also go. It swings back at Watts. What is Watts' AC?
Watts is
actually, never mind. This thing hits AC6. He's not in play. It deals 4 damage, and I need Watts to make a save versus poison.
Okay. Start with the important one here. I think that maybe, let's see, poison and Watts 6 fails.
Yeah.
That's not great.
Toast?
Okay.
Or we get back to him later. Does his hit points matter, I guess, is the question.
That's a good question, so let's check.
You said 3,
I'm
right?
I'm going to just check.
4 damage.
4 damage, okay, thank you.
4 damage, yes. It's okay. Oh.
Oh, no.
I'm sorry, I don't know the poisons very well. Prepped for most of these monsters, but not these particular ones. happens.
Understandable.
It's another good idea stolen from AD&D. Poison types. Totally worth
he
it.
Is
totally
a,
worth
you, you, this is a cheese shop, sir.
This is a patisserie. Wow. Okay.
Well, he Ross, can only die once, I think.
Roll me a d4.
We're about to find out.
Two.
Okay. His face starts to turn red. He's not doing well, but he hasn't fallen over yet.
Oh.
It's probably too, it's in the midst of combat, but can I tell anything through being a healer of what that means? Like what might need to be done like right away to help, if anything?
Yeah. He would need to have his poison cured or he will die.
Nice. Okay. That's the worst and the best. It's like there's nothing we can do.
Is anyone else going on a 6? Is anyone going on a 5?
Thelma is.
Okay.
Alright.
Oh, one of the spiders is also going on a 5. I'm sorry. Procedure. There are fewer of them than you. On a tie, they go first.
That's fair.
This is the one that's engaged with Jagrov. It rolled an 8 to hit. That is a miss.
Oh.
Jagrov lives another day.
Well,
yeah, it claws at him. It claws at him viciously, and somehow he is able to ward it off, perhaps due to its two missing legs. Thelma may take her action.
Perhaps
she misses. She rolls a 3 on her 1d20.
Okay. Yeah, she flails at it, but it flails wildly backwards with its remaining 6 feet. It is unable to do any damage to her, but
she's not the strongest.
Able to accidentally ward off her blow. Is anyone going on a 4? 3.
Yes.
2?
Yes. I've got a spear, so I'm gonna stab it. Do I need to roll in the app or just
You can just roll a d20.
Alright.
Your target number is 10. So a 10 will hit AC 0, and an 11 will hit AC 1, a 12 will hit AC 2, etc.
Alright, I rolled a 9. Do I get a modifier? I don't think so.
No, that 10 plus includes your modifiers for strength and level and everything. So, it's a good stab, but you're unable to find purchase on anything vital.
I was grossed out when it flopped down on me.
And yet you're alive. Is anyone going on a 2? A 1?
Yes. Jagrov.
Go ahead. In whichever order you prefer.
Well. Pretty simple here. Jagrov desperately slashes with his dagger. With his odd-looking dagger. And misses.
Yeah, he's unable to strike back meaningfully, though he makes a good effort. Its ferocity has increased, unusually, as it has lost limbs.
Meet the veil, vile creature.
And it is a vile creature. What does Similaricus do on his turn?
Question. I think I set this aside. I see on Richard's map, did this happen in the corridor beyond the curtain in the 10-foot wide
correct.
Corridor? Okay.
Yes.
All right. So I'm not 20 feet away from the spiders. I was going to attempt to charge. So I will do it. I will get back.
Okay.
I got a 17.
That's a hit. And just to be clear, you're actually engaged potentially with either of them. One of them is to your north and one of them is to your south. You have to pick, but I haven't actually asked you until now which one you would like to engage with.
Well,
once you engage, you're locked in.
Yeah,
you have to pick.
Sure, that's a simple thing, the one that's been having its legs hacked off and looked apparently poisoned someone to death.
The one that poisoned someone is in the north. The one that had a limb hacked off is in the south.
Oh, I'm sorry. They're not. Well, the south one.
Understood. Okay, roll damage. 4 damage.
Yeah.
He brings his mace down heavily on its vicious head. He can see that its mouth isn't like a normal spider's mouth. Normally you would expect chelicerida. Ooh, I can't do words today. That's bad. Spiders have these muscly tooth palps. This one doesn't. It has a mouth that opens wide with 4 vicious fangs. And he smashes it right down across the head, and those fangs splay. It is dead.
Good. Good. I don't like this thing existing.
This is the end of the first combat round. Everyone has survived, but Watts may not be long for the world. Would you like to issue orders for the second round?
Before we proceed to the second round, I want to clear, are we committed to fighting these things? Do we want to just book it?
I think we'll have a better chance fighting this thing. It's fast. There's more of us. There's one of it left.
Okay.
Really? Okay, so the one that just died was the one on me, right?
Yes.
That's correct. You are no longer engaged in melee. Similaricus is engaged from behind and will probably have to turn around to fight his. Holt is still engaged. Telma is no longer engaged. Watts is still engaged. Sandath is no longer engaged.
I don't have any spells or anything. I'm down with fighting.
Okay.
I'm not casting anything.
Understood. Orders for henchmen?
Stab it to death, please.
Stab.
Retreats from stabby. Melee.
Well, Jogrov will move back, certainly.
Okay, yeah.
I think Watts is going to try initiative. To fight.
Yep. Watts is looking worse for the wear, but this poison does not incapacitate. I'm going to double check the ruling on that afterward, but it doesn't seem to say anything that suggests that it does. And he's still standing HP-wise, right? He took 4 damage and he had...
2, so he has a total of 6. 4,
oh,
he's done 2.
Oh, that's a... He was rolling on a d6 for his hit dice, too. Okay. Is anyone going on a 7? On a 6?
Me. How many people are currently engaged with the spider?
3.
Now there are 4. I will move in there and I will slash it with my hand axe.
Understood. That is probably
right.
As many people as will be
natural
able to 20. Get in space.
Okay.
Okay, roll me damage.
2 damage.
Good. It takes 2 damage.
Yeah.
That's a nice solid hit. A bell ringer, if you will.
Doink.
Is anyone else going on a 6? On a 5, it will try to have its revenge on the person who just harmed it.
Oh, I was hoping it would pick randomly between the 4 of us. My AC is 13.
It is unfortunately intelligent enough not to just pick.
Oh, man.
Just barely.
Okay, sorry. My AC is 2. I misremembered.
Okay. I rolled a 17 to hit. That's going to connect. You take 5 damage and roll to save.
Well, I don't have 5 hit points, so I'm afraid they just...
That's okay. You're not dead. You're down.
Okay, but
roll
let's
to save
let's
just
check.
Poison.
Okay. All right, 12. I'm dead. Or dying. 1d4. One turn.
1. Understood. How do you know that's a turn? Who said that to you? Who told you this was a turn?
You can read.
I have my presumptions.
It buries its fangs in Telma and gets through her armor. I have bad news, gentlemen. Monsters can cleave.
Nice.
It's going to turn, and now it will attack someone randomly, because dealt damage to it other than Telma. It is going to attack on evens, Similaricus, on odds, Holt. It rolled a 1, so it will be attacking Holt. It rolls a 3. Well, monsters don't really cleave, guys. Just kidding. It wheels around to try to bite a colt and finds no purchase. He wards it off with his spear, and that is its only action. The rest of you may take your attacks in any order you like, because that's going to be the rest of this. That's going to be the rest of this round. Any actions you would like to take?
Who has room to hit it?
Well, tell them it's down, so actually any 4 people have room to enter melee and hit it.
All right. Well, then, yep.
Jogrov, I was discombobulated.
Jogrov will
miss. Yeah, I missed.
And, however, Sandath.
Richard, I was wrong. I was
also
wrong, Richard.
Yeah.
About what?
Everything. I regret everything. You're like, why are we doing this? I'm like, no,
you said hug the left wall.
We need to do this. We need to do this.
Yeah, sure.
This was a
okay,
good tactical.
So I'm seeing that you've all rolled less than you would need to hit ACs.
I was wrong, Richard.
Hang on a second, sure. I gotta post a meme.
We're about to enter the third round of combat. 2 of your number have been poisoned, but only one is down. Do you have orders for the henchmen?
Fight to the death, you fools.
Okay.
Now
I have bad news about these henchmen, which is that their leader just went down, which means they have to make a morale roll.
Oh, he's dead? Okay, maybe we need to run.
Telma hired all of them, because you all let Telma hire all of them, so. Oh. Okay. They roll. Wow.
I should have. I knew. I meant for Telma to not be cowardly. That's why I asked to make sure that there were 4 people there in the party before I made my action. I should have delayed until after one of you other idiots attacked it before I attacked it. I'm a failure as a Machiavellian.
I forget
both of them. Both of them have rolled to fight on. Spells or orders for henchmen or retreats from melee.
No spells.
Similarcus is like, if only some great magical power would aid us in this moment
okay,
of dire need.
Does he say
I will
that?
If he says that, I will cast a spell.
Whoa. Does he say that?
Yeah.
Is he entreating the patron?
I mean, I can't do that. What are you talking
Please
about?
Please entreat the patron.
Okay, entreat the patron.
Yes, I think he just did. He opened his mouth. The words came out, you know.
The words came out. For what miracle does he entreat the patron?
What is the... I didn't read this. I feel like there's a catch. I feel like this
I'm asking you a question. For what miracle does he entreat the patron?
To smite his enemies.
Really? That's what you're asking for?
And
2 people are poisoned and you're asking to smite your enemies?
I mean, save my friends.
No, it's too late. You said it.
You said smite your enemies. And what oath do you offer in return?
To I love this one. To be loyal to all of my surviving companions unto death.
Roll me 2d6. Add your wisdom. Bonus.
I got 4. You know, I got probably a 5, but it's, you know. Sucked. Well, actually, it's 2d6. Let me look. Sorry. Wisdom, 0.
Okay.
Yeah, 4.
The patron's voice does not stir.
Alas.
But I am going to cast a spell, since I heard him say that.
You had to declare that at the start of the round.
Well, next round. If he's alive. Or if he's not alive.
Okay.
So, all right.
Roll me initiative, if you haven't already. Oh, wait. Did all of that just happen before we rolled initiative? You can cast a spell.
Yes.
As long as you declare it before initiative. I'm sorry, I'm wrong. Oh. Would you like to cast a spell? You're welcome to.
Yes.
I'm failing my own procedure, gentlemen.
Well, because my here's what's going to happen. Very complicated and ironic. The conscience inside me is moved from Similaricus's desperation, and I feel suddenly ashamed and selfish for my own safety that I was, and maybe I could have saved somebody's life if I hadn't been so reticent and fearful. So now.
You're casting.
Grip.
Oh. Okay, the choking grasp will come out. All right.
Honestly, in terms of unholiness, choking grasp is kind of not that unholy. It's, really it's worse than bad. Beating someone to death with a mallet.
It's pretty bad. on a 7. Is anyone going on a 7 or an 8? Is anyone going on a 6?
Is Watts still alive?
Watts is still alive.
Okay, he goes, he attacks. Probably hits.
Roll damage.
He does 4 damage.
Outstanding. He lands a vicious blow with his spear. It is stuck in its hind bits. Because it wasn't facing him. I guess at this point it's turned around. Oh no, it turned to face him during its cleave. Anyway, it's spinning around like a mad spider.
With a
is anyone going
butt.
On... Is anyone going on a... That was 5? Is anyone going on a 4? On a 3?
Yeah, 4. 4 is me.
Go for it.
Nope. I keep missing.
Okay.
Jagrav and... Dang it. Sandath both go on 3.
Okay.
Does the spell go off before the melee attack, or...?
The spell goes off on your initiative.
Okay, it's on a 3, so...
Okay.
Yeah, so... I'm gonna go off with the spell here. It gets a save, I believe,
yep.
Versus death, or something like that.
It gets a save versus spells, I would imagine. It's going to save as a second level.
I think it's not death. Are we sure about this?
Well, you can double check, but I hate to say it doesn't matter to check because it does matter to check, but it rolled a 17, which would pass even on the worst save on its profile. Just barely.
Okay.
Describe the spell just the same. Your signature matters.
I'm holding up my left hand between myself and Similaricus, but it'll still look odd. You'll see the glow, the dark bluish sort of light-sucking glow of that is being shone from the ethereal skull. Hopefully mostly hidden from your vision. Maybe it looks like an orb or something. But my hand begins to shake and you can see me desperately grasping about, and finally I let go and the unlight dissipates.
You are unable to find the creature's throat. As effective as the spell would normally have been. Perhaps these things don't breathe.
Where is your life? Give it to me.
I say in a moment of high dudgeon. Okay,
you
so
feel,
San...
You feel the blackness take you just a little bit more.
Yeah. Sandath makes an attack with a dagger.
Roll
I don't
damage.
Know if that hits. Okay. 2.
And Sandath brings down his dagger heavily on its back. It hisses, tries to bite at his elbow, and then collapses under his weight.
Jagrav stumbles over and leans against a wall, looking a little more shaken than he expected to feel.
Elmo. As this thing's fangs sunk into you, it all started to fade away. That's barely a memory now. You're standing above a great crater, hemmed in from above, and on all sides by a pale dome, its blinding brightness, demanding that you avert your gaze down. All's quiet, save for a low, steady boom, 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 boom. Each stroke tugs at the air around you, beckoning it and you both to draw an inch closer. Closer to the bright, beating heart at the base of the crater. You feel thin. Looking down, you seem to stand in the air, level with the crater's edge. You're standing on nothing. What do the rest of you do?
Jagrav shakes himself and runs over to Telma. Is there anything in my herb collection here that could help at all?
Or in hers, for that matter.
Yeah.
You tell me.
I've got something called wound wart.
Is it fair to say that given the subtle details I saw, I would not have connected the dots on this dark sorcery?
I leave that up to you.
Oh, in that case, I do not.
I do not know if it would be responsible for you not to make a check, but you don't have to decide right now.
Yeah, no, I got one.
Sorry, Ross. Go ahead.
It seemed very subtle to me. So I think that's simple enough. And nonetheless, I think this is already starting to fray his faith, anyways, given the things that he's seen and experienced. So that's all.
Okay. Birthwort, a healing herb used as a remedy for snake bites and other poisons. Birthwort can be applied as a poultice to a poisoned wound by an adventurer with a healing proficiency. Used in this manner, it provides a +2 bonus on the healing proficiency throw to neutralize poison, which I will attempt.
Can you make that? I need you to check, and that may require multiple ranks of healing.
Yes, unfortunately, I believe it does. I went through that rigmarole last time.
Yeah. Was it for poison or for cure light wounds?
Healing. A proficiency throw of 11+ enables the character to identify whether a disease is magical or mundane, and if mundane, diagnose it.
Okay. Yeah, I
guess. If the character selects healing twice, he can neutralize poison, cure disease, or cure light wounds with a proficiency throw of 18+ once per day per patient. With three selections, he can neutralize, cure, or cure serious wound, cure disease, or cure serious wounds on a 14+ once per patient. So one rank does not let you perform miracles. However, you might still want to check Telma for a mortal wound. Just throw that out there.
Well, I'll do that.
Okay. D20 plus D6.
I'm not sure if it'll matter.
Probably won't, but worth a shot. It'd be really funny if it does somehow.
I got a 3 on the D20 roll and a 6 on the D6 roll.
Oh, a 3 on the D20 roll, huh?
Yep.
Okay. That's not good. I'm just going to give it to you straight. That's pretty bad. I will... On the poisonous mortal wound table, a 1 to 5, you're mortally wounded. You die unless healed to 1 HP within 1 round. If you're healed, you need 1 month of bed rest. And what was your D6 roll?
6.
Oh. Her lips and tongue are permanently paralyzed by the poison. She cannot speak clearly, cast spells, or use magic items involving speech. -4 reaction rolls.
Oh man, I hate that.
A 6 is about as good as it gets.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what to tell you other than that the next best option there was she's blinded in both eyes.
Oh no, that's okay.
Okay, she survives then? Is that what that means?
No, she dies unless healed to 1 HP within 1 round.
Oh.
She has 10 seconds to receive.
And she can't tell us about it.
So for the next 10 seconds, she's paralyzed.
You can do that with Pomfrey, but the larger problem is that I still die in a turn because of...
Yeah.
Like, we don't have a way to neutralize the poison. My life is forfeit.
Jagrav stands up and looks at Similaricus. This is perhaps soon to be your domain.
Yeah, his eyes are sunken in the dim torchlight, and his jaw hangs open, and he looks over at the black nothingness that is beyond the windows, and grips his holy symbol tightly, and for the first time in his life, when he's meant to prompt a prayer or certain things that you're supposed to pray about each time, he does not.
And yet the holy symbol feels warm in his hand. Telma, the thinness passes, and with the next beat of the heart, you tumble down with the current from your anchorless perch in the air toward the heart.
Down I go.
And it's going to be the same with Watts, is it not? And another couple of turns.
Nothing bad happens to Watts.
You see Watts sweating and breathing heavily. But I'm not playing him, so, you know, what he says is up to you guys.
Richard, did you say something about comfrey? Because I've got that on my sheet.
Yes. Comfrey can be used by a character with a healing proficiency to, once per day per character, restore 1d3 hit points. It's effectively a very terrible healing potion. But if you have minus one hit point, as Telma did, that would be enough to restore her to health. It's just in her case, it would be kind of pointless because...
The poison.
Yeah. She's gone. Sorry. No one I'd rather go out with than you guys, though.
So we just wait with Watts, then?
That's up to you. He doesn't look like he has long, but he's still on his feet. I'm not playing him, so I can't speak for him, but he's still on his feet. He's probably got another 10 minutes. He's fading.
Yeah, he actually starts freaking out and is kind of like a gibbering, mewling mess. He's lost everything. His village has been burned to the ground. Most of the people he knows are gone. And then he came to do something about it and has lost everything. And he is in terror.
Let us walk outside.
Okay, he does that then. If he can.
Is there a way I can, like, walk off with Watts to where the flowers are?
look at the pretty flowers, Watts.
You know, I don't think you can walk off to where the flowers are, but in 10 minutes, if you're not moving at exploration speed, you can absolutely make it to and out the door.
Yeah.
If you'd like to.
I think it would be.
You did win this fight, though, and there are also there's more in this room if you guys would like to continue your investigation.
Mike, I'm still lawful for now. I have enough of a conscience not to want the guy to just die in the dark while we look for treasure.
Yeah,
understood.
So.
Well, you'll be able to walk out with him. He's not limping or anything, but he's breathing heavily. He'll be moving at half speed, but if you're just walking, that's fine. There is no encounter on your way out.
Well, stay with our friends, and if anything, Similaricus will try to. So, but first of all, Telma's just dead, right? Straight up dead.
She's gone.
Okay. Similaricus will force himself to offer comfort to Watts, and when it becomes clear that he is not going to get better, to him, he will just hold him, and he will sing canticles of comfort and promise until he stops breathing.
Okay. Watts will probably find this comforting. Though he fell in a nasty battle, he did bring down two unnatural creatures of undeniable chaos. Well above a single soldier's station.
Yeah. If that sort of thing is important in this culture, to a Skonin's at least, I don't know about Bremen's, but he'll note that. But, yeah.
Bremen was founded by pushing back creatures of chaos in the wastes, in their own home. This is how many men have died, establishing this country and pushing out its borders.
Yeah. Also,
it's an honest way to go.
Has Similaricus ever seen a monster?
Not like these ones.
Yeah. He'll look over also.
But he's heard of them.
Okay.
In stories. This isn't the first time he's heard of anything like this. It's just not common to see one.
Okay. Okay.
Right out of there.
And okay. Let's see, we're two people down.
Yes.
Holt is. What do you think?
Well, it's in the middle of the night right now, right?
Yeah, that's a good point.
The sun has just set. It's sun's been down for maybe 20 minutes.
Back to Aspen. Is it reasonable to try to get back out onto the road, or at least to the village? I don't know how far it is.
12 effective miles.
12
it would take
miles.
You 4 hours of travel.
Maybe it would be better to at least get out of the forest.
Yeah.
And get back to the village and set up camp under torchlight.
Okay, that would constitute a forced march, but you can do it.
We need that forced march. We need to. Maybe we should camp in the woods then, since we need that when combat comes, if it happens.
Yeah. Yeah. I think we should lie down here. Holt, I would add, without Tama, we've lost some of our wilderness guide skills, but you've been doing this for a while. Can you help us find a place where we can hunker down where we won't get eaten by those little snapshot critters?
I'm back.
Welcome back, man. Oh, sorry, I would like to reclaim use of Sandath as my temporary PC, if that is okay.
Totally fine with me.
All right.
Okay.
Is he the crazy one, or is Ramit the crazy one? I mean, we're all crazy, but I mean, the one where he's just like, spider eggs.
I was
like that guy, you know?
He's the one who was enthused about fire.
Yeah.
Ramit will be devastated that Telma is dead when you reach him, by the way. This is someone, you know, these two grew up together. They weren't close, but a village isn't that big.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's set up camp.
Rough day.
Yeah, rough day. This is one. There's only been a couple of times where I've gotten my butt so thoroughly licked time after time. I'm trying to think. I think it was a Dungeon Crawl Classics campaign I was in where I lost three characters, and two in a row.
This wasn't supposed to be like DCC, guys. I'm so sorry.
No. This is. I am enjoying this.
Yeah, I am too. Yeah. Yeah.
If nothing else, you get to make. Did you see the memes I posted in Landing?
No, we'll go back to it afterward. Time is of the essence.
Okay, good.
So,
you're
heading back out of the forest, if I understood that correctly?
We don't want to forest march. We want to... I think the plan was to hunker down
somewhere.
You want
somewhere. To camp in the forest?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Holt will scout out a good, safe little area.
Yeah, no problem. A mile down the road, you're going to find a nice overhanging rock. It's not very tall, but it's certainly tall enough for the horse to stand up underneath it. You only brought the one horse, right? Did I understand that correctly?
That's what we said.
Yep. You'll be able to load up the fallen on the horse, and you'll be able to make it to the spot that he's spotted. He's a land surveyor, by the way, so he's excellent at this. If anyone were going to have a bonus finding this, it was going to be him or someone with survival. And so he finds it like that. He saw it on the way in. He's like, he knows exactly where to go. You're able to make a sheltered camp. Are you burning a fire?
Well, is it cold?
35 degrees.
I'd be
overcast. Moderate winds, but it's above freezing. And the overhang does help with the wind.
Go ahead.
How hardened are we? I mean, probably. What does Holt think?
What I have had a sense that this was kind of off away from game trails and, you know, where wild animals are.
Good spot. Yeah. It's not a freebie, but he picked a good spot.
I think a little fire would be good for us.
Okay. So have I understood you're camping with a fire for the night?
Yeah.
Yes.
The night passes without incident. It's quiet. Things that see by moonlight stay hidden. And even things that see at night tend not to see with no light at all. You rise a little late the next morning, just because you tucked in a little late, but the sun has risen, the weather is clear. It's promising to be quite hot. A warm front has moved in, and you've been lucky to be spared the rains wherever the two fronts collided. The skies are clear.
We have a long way to go home. We do not know what is in that cavern. Could just be that entire...
I suggest we... Oh, no, I apologize.
I was going to say that it could just be spiders and spider webs and eggs all the way back to the back of it.
What, you think there might be more in there? Right now, that place has turned a profit on us, and I don't like that.
I don't know that there's any way to know. I'm just trying to think in Similaricus, like, if it were me, I'd be like, that place could just be full of spiders, you know? I don't know. Seems like a reasonable thing. All that to say, we may be carrying more bodies out, or we may not make it out at all if we keep the horses here and run the risk of trying to go back in there. I suppose we could at least scorch those bodies and go just to see if there's any further webbing. But
we should, if they have killed others such as they did today, perhaps there are rewards, not to sound impolite, but to have the expedition be fruitless would be very frustrating.
Fruitless? My man, we've already got a 400 foot tall fruit. We know things about this place now. Things and knowledge passes from tongue to ear as freely as water flows down the stream. You tell people, if we let more people know about this place, it'll get stripped bare in no time. Free opportunity beckons like that, especially in this part of the world. So it's not fruitless yet. She was a scout. We scouted. We found something. Question is,
we must agree in that case to keep secret our finding.
Either that or abandon it. Either keep it secret or tell everyone. One or the other.
I have a stupid question. No, actually, it would be Jagrov. Jagrov, I know that you are a master of the natural philosophy and of wisdom study. Do you think it'd be possible that you could relay some record? I don't know if you know much about languages, but we know what these little creatures look like, but if we're to come here again, we need to know what these little creatures are. It is too odd that they stand guard outside this place and then admit entrance for a fee. It is too odd.
We will attempt to make discreet inquiry. However, we must be very careful how we discuss these topics. I, for one, have no desire to see swarms of other fools such as ourselves throw themselves against this monstrosity. But yes, I will endeavor it. I know nothing of the... I don't think I've made a lore roll on those little creatures, but I don't remember precisely. Is that what you're asking for?
My thought is, initially I thought maybe if I had some... I'm thinking I'm getting my games mixed up, and Tui, the papyrus paper is cheaper than the regular paper, and I was like, do I have paper and a writing stick? And anyways, I don't have those things, so I thought maybe you would, to try to get a sense of, like, you know, we can describe these things, but if we could figure out what their language is, we could find somebody that is an expert, and maybe we could speak to them. But if none of us speak their language, and we have no way of conveying what their language is, we have no way of, like, figuring out what this is about. And,
real quick, I'm going to send, to Richard what I sent to Father Chris about Sandath, because what you're asking is an answered question.
Okay.
And the gaze turns towards the question. Towards the direct messages chat.
My apologies, this is just a copy paste. Carry on. You're asking, Jagrov.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that was it.
What are you asking? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, to see if you could attain some record of a portion of their language to test it out. You know, like, fine. We could get one word or one bit of syntax. We could record that and get it back and figure out what the language is.
I mean, Sandath pauses a second and says, the language of the Beastmen, you know, it's known. Not what? Widely, but...
I'm sorry? You know what they're saying?
No. But there are people who know it. It's not some mysterious, unknown thing. People write on it. People think of it.
You think these little creatures are the Beastmen?
Beastmen's a big category. Covers a lot of people. But as far as I know, there's only one tongue, which is the bestial tongue. And it's spoken by all things that are called beastmen. And I've heard a little bit of it, and I think that what those guys were speaking was that.
I see. Well, perhaps we could find an expert on that. And
perhaps so.
Then we could get to the bottom of this. We could solve a lot of problems if we didn't have to cut through spiders that were as big as a man.
As big as a dog. They were smaller than a man. They were the size of Labradors.
Hey, man, you want to tell people that we got killed by spiders the size of a man? I'm not gonna contradict you.
Yes, they were.
Sorry.
Enormous.
Telma died in battle against a spider the size of her entire village.
Oh, I hate the idea.
You said
of a
it. I believe it.
Size of a dog, anyway. I hate it. I hate it. I don't like it.
Woof woof woof.
Oh.
All right. I looked over at the geograph. You think those things will let us pass for another gold? Because I want to go. I really want to see what the heck
yes.
was in that. What those creatures, what those spiders
yes.
were guarding.
Two men agree.
Died to take.
I'm Even sure. Just... I am sure. I am sure that it will. Shall we go?
Worst case scenario,
camp?
I think we.
Yeah.
I think we should go. I think we should go check them out.
Let us go. We are on. At any trouble.
Agreed. You know, it's funny. Telma told me she wanted to be real careful, come out of this alive. She got real brave all of a sudden. Didn't work out so great for her.
It was almost me, my friend.
Say again?
Ramit wants to leave.
His will to stay is completely broken. He's being polite about it, but he's telling you he wants to resign. If you're going in, he's not leaving the camp.
Perhaps you should stay.
This is, agreed. Yes, yes, stay with the camp. This will not take long.
He wants to know how long he should wait before he just leaves.
2 hours?
Yeah, if we're not back
It'll
by
take
noon.
You an hour to get there and an hour to get back.
What time is it now? It's like 7-ish?
It's an hour after sunup, plus an hour delay, I guess. Cause normally
so
it's
more like 9-ish.
Yeah, still early, but yeah.
If we're not back like 2 canticles after noon, get out of here. That sound right to you?
Agreed. Yeah.
Ramit, the hospital at Sill's Bend, they know the proper rites, even if there's no body.
Yeah. Yeah, she would have wanted to go there.
I know what we'll do for her, he'll say.
Go on in.
Take care of yourself, wild man.
Oh, son of a gun. Oh, I hate this. Oh, no.
Yes.
Complications.
Oh, no.
5 spiders.
Complications. Gentlemen.
What nonsense has been drawn up from the urn of chaos to torment us now?
I need you to roll surprise. This is a wilderness encounter, so you're just rolling to see who spots whom first.
It's similar because you roll it. I already rolled once.
I guess it depends on the creature. I got a 3.
It just depends on you, actually.
Oh, do I have a... okay.
No, I mean, it's just a roll for the party, and then people will add their bonus or penalty. Most creatures do not have a surprise penalty. That is a rare thing for camouflaged creatures. And actually, I'm wondering if I should have applied it at all, because you guys spotted the spider eggs. That may have been an error on my part.
No, I agree with it. I agree.
We'll go over that.
Yeah, that of
yeah, but the module
people,
does
it actually,
the last line
no,
of that room.
I actually...
However, characters who are on their guard because they found the spider eggs in room 11 do not suffer the penalty, so...
I would
not
describe us as on guard.
Yeah,
like,
that's...
I of all...
I'll tell you about
That was my thought later. Yeah, that was my thought, is like, oh, there are spider eggs, dang it. And then we just keep going. And that's, I don't know. I think that some of you should not have been.
I think that Sandath and Jagrov should have not gotten the penalty, because it doesn't apply equally to everyone.
Like, we should have immediately been like, you know what? We should check the ceiling in the next room. Like, that should have been the most obvious thing. And if
the
we had
is
said
whether
that,
I should have considered that SOP, but
no.
In this case, you didn't.
I disagree with the module.
In the future, you can bear in mind that that's the sort of thing that the module says, and I actually think that's a reasonable procedure. So if you say, stumble across something and say, we're on guard for X,
okay,
you will receive that sort of... But you know, don't try to stack your SOP. Exploration speed already allows you not to...
What horrifying thing assails us now?
Yes.
That's a good question. It's a really good question, what horrifying thing assails you now.
Maybe it's not horrifying. Maybe it's cute and cuddly. Maybe it's entrancing and beautiful. Maybe it's...
Striges.
I don't know what that word is, but that sounds pretty good.
I don't like those.
Bunch of strixes, if you will.
On
your way up to the... sorry, I've kind of given it away. On your way up to the dome, you see on the side of the trail... On the side of the dusty trail, you see a prone figure spasming.
Like a human guy?
You know, you're not actually close enough to tell right away. As you get a little bit closer, you realize it's a body being drained by four striges.
Let's just leave.
They seem to have noticed you. You seem to have noticed them.
Do we know anything? I am going to emit the hunting call of a bird of prey, because on the assumption that that might be what hunts these creatures.
Roll me a d20.
Okay.
What kind of bird of prey?
I'm trying to think of one. A falcon, because a fast-moving falcon could swat one of these things out of the sky and kill it on its way down. An owl wouldn't hunt these things at night, because these things are probably quiescent, since they are not nocturnal creatures, and they hunt. I don't know. It just They feel like falcon food to me. Okay, I'm a city boy.
I roll a three anyway.
Oh, I got
you
a
roll
three.
Well, it was a three plus. Roll me 2d6 plus two. Plus your charisma.
Okay.
You're trying to intimidate them.
2d6 plus 2 plus my charisma. Okay.
That's correct. I'm offering you a plus 2 bonus for the successful animal call.
Twelve.
Wow. Congratulations. You guessed right. They are terrified of giant falcons.
Yeah.
And Sandath's voice booms as though that of a great rock coming down out of the sky, and these creatures of chaos flit back and forth in the trees looking for the creature that hunts them from above, and then scatter. I don't know what else to do with a perfect roll. So, okay.
I don't know. I feel like I'd need help if Richard could, like, act it out more and then I could see it. Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
There you go. I know what you want to see. He does the wings, too. He does the wings. He gets in character.
Yeah.
It's the strangest thing you've ever seen him do, and it would probably be cause for laughter if it didn't just save one of our lives, probably.
You guys don't know what you just heard, by the way. Sandath has never done anything like this in your presence before, and you've only known him for a day, or two, or three, or something like that. And you think you just heard the biggest hawk that you've ever heard. You thought it was another monster.
And death is becoming the hero of the story. Martin,
do you have any water?
He is a man.
Do you have any wine?
Oh, no.
I'm not even sure that was the correct way to roll that, but you got a perfect result, and we're going with it. So, congratulations. You have frightened off a party of Strix, and they proceed along your path unmolested.
I am not... I really want to get that money. Or whatever. I don't know what's in there. Look, I'm going to be honest, man. If I get there and that room is completely empty, I will at least be able to stop thinking about it. I want to know.
As you proceed past the site where this body was being drained by these long-beaked hawks, you see that it was likely a brigand, a deserting soldier. He's wearing leather armor and was carrying a short sword and a short bow, and has a couple of arrows still left in his quiver. Actually, a good number of arrows still left in his quiver, 13.
I'm going to steal his sword, and I'm going to steal his arrows, and I'm going to move on.
And by that, you know, if that's the qualifiers for being a brigand, I think we're brigands.
Being
we are,
so
let's not
soldier?
Talk about it.
Yeah.
Sandoth wants his armor, even though he can't use it yet.
Well, maybe I'll
That's
grab it on
money.
The way back. Oh, Telma's got one, too. Whatever. I'll get
oh, right.
I'll get
I'm not
way.
Playing Sandoth anymore. Hey, buddy. I'm sorry.
Hi.
You tell me what you want. My
well, I'm stealing his sword, and I'm stealing his sword. I've got plenty of arrows. I need that. I want a better sword. And if we pass him on the way back, I'll strip
you
him.
You can keep it.
Yeah.
You're not trained to use it. You're zero level. You can use a dagger and a short bow.
Okay, fine. Well, I can still sell it.
You can. Or brandish it.
Yes.
You proceed to the entrance. We're coming up short on time, but you guys will reach the entrance an hour into the day. You proceed up to the door.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, let's...
The...
Oh, yeah, that's right.
The beasts at the entrance hiss and wave you in.
Wow.
Oh, our first gold piece is still good.
Nice.
Wow. Okay.
Sanda thinks he catches one of the words that they say. In. He thinks he's learned the word for in.
In.
Or come or something like that. But he synced it up with the motion in, and he thinks he's making something of it. It's starting to click.
I nod casual.
You proceed into the doorway.
Mm-hmm.
What's your marching order, and do you light a torch?
I mean, we need a torch, and Sandath will carry it.
Yeah, I'll go up front, of course.
Lots rip.
Did you take any gear from these guys, by the way?
From the people who we... From our dead, you mean?
Yeah.
Sure.
If you did, let me know afterward. It's fine.
Okay.
We'll keep going.
We're
gonna. Yeah,
I mean, Jagrav will have certainly taken Telma's, if she had, like, herbs and stuff like that, but...
She did. Add +1 wound wart and +1 comfrey.
Okay.
Great. And I guess none of you can really use any of the other weapons that they had, and you already had shields and stuff. So,
mm-hmm.
Carry on. Okay. In you go. Where do you go? You're inside
same place.
The door.
Left, right, through wall.
Are you moving at exploration pace, or are you just walking?
I think we're just walking.
Really? Okay. Interesting.
We're in a hurry.
Fair enough. As you round the corner, you hear talking. Roll me surprise.
Oh, beans. Rolling, okay, thank you.
2.
Are you surprised?
No. Unless they have a feature about it.
No, that's not normal. I will tell you after the fact, if that's a thing.
You each roll surprise separately, or no? It's
no,
for
you
all
just
of
roll it once as a party and use all your separate modifiers.
Okay.
Individual surprise is an option, but it's too many rolls.
Yeah.
I think. You've caught them by surprise. What you see are four, sort of 3 to 4 foot tall, furry, snouted creatures. There's four of them, sort of chattering to themselves around that area at the southern wall where it's started to fall in. Mm-hmm. You haven't yet reached that second door that leads west into the room with the skeleton and that you burned the eggs on.
Mm-hmm.
They're chittering amongst themselves. Yes.
Do they resemble the creatures out front?
No, these are different. Those ones had scales and basically looked like bipedal caimans.
I honestly don't know what to do. To be, I don't know. Whatever you guys think. My instinct is let's just kill them. But
What is their reaction to seeing us?
They didn't see us.
They've been taken by surprise. You have a surprise round.
Only have like a moment.
Don't
outnumber them.
Are they smaller than us?
Yeah, the tallest one of them is about 3.5 feet tall.
Is it clear to us what they're doing? Are they just standing there talking? Or are they in the middle of doing something? Or
they're standing there, chittering not too loudly amongst themselves, standing in front of this door. That you guys busted open. By the way, did you close that door yesterday on your way out, or did you leave it open?
We left it open. We were in a hurry. We were not thinking completely clearly.
If you wanted to, you have had time to close it. Either way. So they're standing in front of this door, which you have left however you've left it. You see these things, they have, in the torchlight as you're rounding it, you see they've got black eyes with fiery red pupils and long, flat snouts. Full of teeth. They got these flared tusks that kind of flare out, pointing downward from the top edges of their jaw, like a really hideous chevron mustache.
I hate to note, but on a couple of things. First of all, we do seem to be out of time, and I say that also because this seems like an interesting decision, and I honestly don't know what to do.
You want a cliffhanger on
it? It would be an interesting cliffhanger. I don't know. I'm of absolutely two minds. I don't know what to do.
Well, we did say if we ran into any trouble, we would book it. So we could just leave and come back and start next session at the beginning back in town.
Well, we'll lose that one. Well, actually, you know what? No, we wouldn't lose that one.
My instinct is to move past them, facing them. Making it very clear through our armedness and serious game faces that they ought not to bother us and just move on.
Okay, you're going to have to walk straight past where they are to get to that door. Okay, so in our last minute here, as we're wrapping up, I'm going to say...
Can we get a reaction?
We're
going to
at least do the reaction and see how this goes.
There are friends
they seem
now.
Shocked when you get, they seem shocked when you get up close, and they brandish their little spears at you.
I mean, look, these beastmen so far have been some of the most reasonable people we've encountered. So I don't know.
You gave them a lot of money, and they let you walk through.
We've given the humans way more money than that.
Because it's a quality of life issue.
Okay,
Sandath tosses him a couple gold and says, "In."
One of them speaks back. It seems confused. It says, "In where?"
I point to the door.
And it crosses its arms as if to say. And says something you think maybe it means locked.
Oh.
Let's just keep walking. say
they brandish their spears. They don't want you to. They don't want you to pass. Exactly. Oh. Not yet. One of them says something like, you recognize it as some sort of challenge. You're not sure if they're saying who or why or what, but it's an interrogative of some
it's
kind.
All reasonable so far, I gotta say. I don't know.
Ed. Sorry. Body. Fetch.
They say a word that you suspect means kin. In the midst of a sentence, that's the one that you catch. And then they say in. Kin. In.
Yes.
They point to themselves and say that.
Oh.
But then another interrogative. You're not sure whether that was a statement or a question. It really could have been either.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Kin death in.
Just try. And, you know. Yeah.
Okay, roll me 2d6.
I pull out another. I reach into my pocket and I pull out like
another. You've given the money. This is the reaction for that. This is the reaction for that. Roll me 2d6 and add. How much gold did you give them?
Three gold.
Three gold. How many of you are there?
Four of us.
Four of you.
Yeah.
It'll hold out its hand as if it's asking for more gold, with the coins in it, as though it's asking for more gold.
I give him another two.
What are they doing with the gold? Just some kind of like
it'll sigh and it'll motion you in. It'll turn and turn to the others and shrug and say something that you're not 100% clear on the meaning of yet, but it's the word is sticking in your head.
Need to find a book on this.
You're able to pass into the doorway.
Wow.
Unmolested. They seem surprised when you walk in.
Wow.
Yep. Sandath tips his hat and closes the door behind us as we go in.
It hits you immediately that the word that they had said to you means fools.
Teach me this word.
We're just a couple minutes over. Do you want to proceed to the area where you were yesterday and see if anything interesting happens there?
Yes, let's wrap that up real quick if we can.
Okay. You'll return to the abandoned room past the tattered curtain on the western doorway. What you find within are a bunch of jars, clay jars, most of them broken along the western wall below the series of windows that are opening directly onto a wall of black granite.
Mm-hmm.
A few of the jars seem like they aren't broken. And there's also a pile of desiccated corpses in the northern end of the room, the northernmost end of the room.
This is new.
As well as the two bodies of the spiders. No, it doesn't look new. It looks like you just missed it in the fracas.
Oh.
You guys got attacked before you really got your investigation underway of this room.
All right,
you kind of spotted them in the corner, but you weren't sure if it was a pile of
bodies. Let's search the bodies and then
poke the bodies with a stick to see if horrible insects come out to attack. Horrible poisonous insects come out first. Then
no,
we loot.
These look like they're pretty dried. It's three of those sort of caimanid creatures on inspection, and two of the things that you just walked past with the flared tusks and the long snouts.
Check their urns.
Treasure?
Yeah,
the jars and urns that aren't broken appear to have good seals. You'll be able to assess from the ones that are the same shape and appear to be the same age as them that these probably hold incense, oils, perfumes, things like that.
Cool. Let's just take those with us.
Okay, there are 10 of them, and they're each going to weigh one stone.
Wow.
Well,
but they're probably worth a decent chunk each. You would think they're probably worth 25 gold at market.
This is like going through the Dwemer ruins, trying to pick up all the dwarven cogs.
Okay.
Just like, oh man, 50 gold. Yeah, but it's 50 pounds.
I can carry... a month's wage.
Okay, hang on a second. I can carry 6.
I carry anything.
I
slower,
have a minus
so.
1 to my strength. Yeah. I don't.
I think we can just go slower and we can just
Yeah, go. Let's just.
If you have anything that is worth less than 25 gold pieces and is a stone, you can just ditch it.
That's a good point.
I don't, actually.
Okay.
Before we go, also have one other thing on them. If you investigate those, you'll find that one of them has a big dark red garnet. I guess all garnets are dark red, aren't they? That you would think is worth 250 gold pieces.
Holy shit.
What about these urns?
What about them?
Yeah, we're going to carry them out.
Let's have a glance inside of them.
Uh-huh. They're stoppers.
Oh, those are things we're carrying? Okay.
Yeah,
they're sealed. You'd have to break the seals to open them. But, I mean, if you're going to sell them in short order, you don't think that that's too much of an issue, if indeed they do contain what the others appear to have contained.
Off the top of anybody's head, what's your max? I should write this down. I know, but
20
is 20. Okay, always 20. Well, if it's 20, I can go pretty wild. I can carry probably all 10, and we'll just go at like the slowest movement rate. So got options.
Okay, that would be 30 feet per turn exploration, or 10 feet per round.
If I carry one. 5 and you carry 5, I can move at 90.
Okay, if so, I carry like, 5, I'm still going to be at 30. So ultimately, I can carry 3, and we'll be at 60. Otherwise,
what are you carrying them in? These are pretty big. You know, we're talking about 10 pound. I mean, they're not that big, but they're, you know, it's not like you could just hold 10 of them in your arms. Do you have sacks and backpacks and stuff?
I do have. Jogger
has a backpack, which
okay,
tell
great,
me how to backpack, which I definitely stole.
No problem.
Okay.
Between the backpacks and your hands, you'll be able to carry them all.
All right.
But it will leave you at something of a disadvantage if you get attacked on the way out.
All right. Well, before we leave, I would like to take the time to take all these desiccated monster corpses, pull them out from their unhappy resting place, line them out neatly in the anteroom, and you know, so that these guys can retrieve their kin.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Not a huge deal, but just want to make sure, like...
That's very considerate.
Giant spider corpse?
This is a very polite dungeon. This is the most polite dungeon I've ever been in, say.
So far, yes.
Other than the spiders, but I don't care.
Is there any monetary value
spiders
to the spider corpse? Is there any monetary value to the spider corpses at all?
Boy, am I glad you asked. Axe says yes. So tell me, do any of you have 2 ranks in the animal husbandry proficiency?
No.
I'm sorry.
I don't
friends,
think that word means
know,
what you think
you
that
just,
means. I don't.
You just have this itching at the back of your mind, like, this has got to be worth money. It's got to be worth money. I just don't know what's worth money.
Draugr, can you carry one of these dead creatures over your shoulder?
I mean, again, I think my strength is 7.
That doesn't actually affect anything except your maximum carry weight. And it only drops it from 20 to 19.
I'm willing to.
I think I can carry it.
Are going to weigh about 12 stone a piece.
Oh, no. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it's crazy. Weight of all the...
Then I guess these belong to the goblins.
Okay. All right. Yeah, that wasn't. You don't have to take them. I was just didn't want to overlook the possibility. Okay.
Thank you.
And you're planning to return with these findings.
Mm-hmm.
The gem and the 10 jars.
Yes.
Okay. You'll take one last wistful look at the ichor-stained floor. Where your friends fell, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
And when you open the door, these 4 creatures that you gave a few gold to are just gone. They moved on.
Nice.
You will be able to return to... Is your plan to return to the entrance? Did I understand that correctly, just because of time?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you return to the entrance untroubled. The creatures at the doorway... The guards eye you suspiciously. They hold out their hand for more coin and say, a word that you're now recognizing as tribute.
Oh. Well. Wow.
Let's see, how much have I given up so far? I stole all this money anyway. I give them another 3 GP.
Oh. They count how many of you there are.
I'd toss in a couple more
coins. They can, I mean, they can count past
one
3.
Gold piece per, 1 gold per person. Do not rip yourselves off.
All right, fine. All right, Holt, it this sounds like Holt covers the last one.
It is the new normal.
Holt pays the fourth gold piece, and you guys are permitted to leave. Untroubled.
Soon we must kill them. You all know this, yes?
I don't know. So far, they're one of the chillest people we've met.
They are not. But they like gold.
All right.
If we keep passing their doors, they will only demand more.
True enough. But so far, we're making a tidy profit, if you don't count the prices of our dead.
Yeah, that would be a big oversight to not count the price of the dead. You will make
Jagrav is silent on that matter.